It's a pleasure today to welcome you to this public event jointly presented by the Leadership and Public Policy Program and the new Institute for Public Policy at Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. The new Institute for Public Policy, which just started this year, is intended to be the kind of conduit for the world's expertise and bringing outstanding people to Hong Kong to share their insights and their knowledge on matters of public policy. Our goal is to help Hong Kong and to help Hong Kong be a leader for China, Asia, and the world. We know there are a lot of issues to cover, but one of the most important is understanding the future economic opportunities for Hong Kong and how Hong Kong can best go about seizing those opportunities. As you all know, Hong Kong has done very well out of the growth of China. For the last 20 years, it's been a terrific run. But growth in China is slowing down. The nature of Chinese economic growth is shifting more to services than the import and export of goods. And so this means the traditional strengths that Hong Kong has enjoyed in shipping and insurance and trade are going to be impacted. We're already seeing the impact on retail in Hong Kong. So if we're going to build a better future for young people in Hong Kong, keep Hong Kong's economy strong, and have Hong Kong known as a leader, we're going to have to find some new economic directions to go forward. And to help us envisage those possibilities, I'm very glad to be able to introduce Dr. Charles WESSNER. Our guest today, Dr. WESSNER currently teaches global innovation policy at Georgetown University. He's a distinguished scholar and has been a powerful advocate of effective innovation policies around the world. He is a scholar of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences and Engineering, and he spent many years as director of the National Academy's Program on Technology, Innovation, and Entrepreneurship. Dr. WESSNER is recognized internationally for his expertise on innovation policy, including public-private partnerships, entrepreneurships, early-stage financing for new firms, and the special needs and benefits of high technology industry. He's advised agencies of the United States government, but also many other governments abroad, including Canada, Australia, France. He's done briefings for government ministers and senior officials on policy issues associated with international technology cooperation, investment, and trade. In addition to launching the National Academy's Innovation Policy Forum, Dr. WESSNER is currently analyzing the potential of the New York nanotechnology cluster. The overarching goal of Dr. WESSNER's work is to develop a better understanding of how we can bring new technologies forward to address global challenges in health, climate, energy, water, infrastructure, security, and a host of other areas. I'm delighted to be able to introduce Dr. WESSNER to you, and I look forward to his comments. We're going to go for about 40, 45 minutes and then have plenty of time for your questions. Dr. WESSNER.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. There we go. Thank you very much for that kind introduction. It's certainly a pleasure to be here. And I very much look forward to the questions, and if there is a pressing question, by the way, or an observation as I'm speaking, please don't hesitate to intervene. This is not a classroom, but we certainly would encourage having any kind of interaction that would prove positive, and I. I apologize, but that was very helpful. So I want to avoid the drowning the computer syndrome as you begin your talk. So I'm going to talk about a number of things here today. Some of the key questions that you'll see are basically what kind of competition are we looking at? One place where you are assuredly competitive is with views like this. This is absolutely spectacular. I once gave a talk in Istanbul on the Bosphorus, and it was evening, and it was absolutely beautiful, and they were going to close the curtains. And I said, no, give the audience an option. And you would have the same here. But I'd like to talk about how can Hong Kong compete in the new competition today? And the question that Professor Goldston asked me to address in particular is what's the appropriate role in that competition? And what practices represent best practice around the world? I want to make one quick observation, if I may. This is a little bit of a strange topic for me, because most of the time, people are asking me what to do and how to do it. They're not asking me whether we should do it. So, in all candor, you're a little bit behind the curve here if this is a really pressing policy concern. Because for those of you who've had a big lunch and want to doze a little bit, the short answer is you've got a lot to do and you better get on with it. But you don't have to, and I'll explain why in just a few minutes. You heard Professor Goldston's observations here. We have a whole series of mega challenges. I'm just back from Brussels, and one of the things that I find, well, not back, I mean, I was in Brussels and went to the United States, and now I'm here. But the thing that troubles me sometimes is the idea that's prevalent in Europe that somehow we can just stop, that we really, if we stopped investing in technologies, we could, everything would be okay, and perhaps we could go back to some more pristine place. Well, the pristine place is actually forward. The only way we can survive on this planet is to go forward. Our existing technologies are not doing the planet any good. I hope I don't need that to explain to you. But whether it's global health or addressing climate change, finding new ways of providing the energy we need without damaging the planet, all those things require innovation. And it always will require innovation both from governments as well as industry. Now today I'm going to talk at some length about the importance of government. Please do not be confused that in any way understates the operational role of industry. It's not an either or, cannot be an either or. The imperative that I think I've touched on is for places that want to grow and maintain their competitive position and address the challenges we've talked about, need collaboration between large and small businesses and the government. And often you need new laws and new institutions and new incentives. Why do I emphasize that? Because new laws, new incentives, new institutions are hard. I'm always reminded of a wonderful observation by a Swedish diplomat. He said, I can assure you that the Swedes understand the global challenges we face, and they're willing to do whatever is necessary to meet them, as long as nothing changes. And that, of course, is a challenge that we all face. So how are we going to learn, how are you going to compete effectively, and what can you learn elsewhere? The key is that there is this need for change, and change is hard. But you also have to remember that your success today, as Professor Goldston mentioned, is not assured in the future. Things are changing very rapidly. I just noticed on the monitor outside that Microsoft is pulling out of cell phones. Microsoft thought they could do very well in cell phones. It seems that they cannot. And it's troubling when you realize that you have one of the largest corporations, one of the best technical corporations, one of the richly financed corporations, and it's not working. So for those of you who are happy where Hong Kong is today, I think you might want to think a little bit about that going forward. So you don't have to do this, by the way, as I mentioned a minute ago. But effective innovation policy is a major differentiator. Not every region is focused on innovation. Not every country is focused on innovation, but the successful regions and the successful countries are focused on innovation. And one of the hardest things to do is to act on opportunities in advance of your competitors and to get ahead of the market. A number of countries, and I'll talk about them briefly, are providing five areas. One, they're focused at a high level on growth. This is something where I think East Asian countries stand out across the world as being more focused. There's sustained support for universities, the build-out in universities. I was just out on the campus of the University of Science and Technology here. It's absolutely amazing facilities. And one of the things, you know, I walked around yesterday and I saw this huge new complex for nanotechnologies, a huge new beautiful business school, and a big sign up about prizes for innovation. I mean, this is already best practice, moving into the new technological areas, making sure people are trained to exploit them, and having the incentives. I mean, this is what you want. And again, often when I'm in East Asia, I wonder why I'm talking. But the broader point is that support for universities, competitive funding for research. We'll talk more about some of Hong Kong's issues. But one of the things that I dread when I'm in Europe and I'm concerned about here is when I hear block funding, where everybody distributes the money across to the institutions based on the fact that they're already there with marginal changes, coming down, top down. That's a good example of bad practice. It's not the way you drive the most original research. Some of you may have heard of China. One of the things that is just so impressive with them is how hard they've been working on building out first world R&D infrastructure and facilities, developing world-class universities, acquiring technologies and talent from abroad, including sea turtles. Does that mean that everything they're doing works every time, the first time? No, not at all. Is there wastage in the system? Absolutely. But they keep working. They keep investing. They're literally a model for the rest of the world. They've been focused on manufacturing, and that is arguably a pattern of success. But there's another one here with Singapore. Some people say, particularly in Europe, well, China is really big. They have these huge assets. They're a billion people. Well, how about Singapore? Not big, not a billion people, but very substantial investments, very serious efforts to attract the skilled R&D workforce from all over the world. That is already one of the best practices, is drawing in foreign talent, bringing in the best and the brightest to teach your students, to use your facilities. And what is sometimes left out, one of the really important things about bringing in foreign talent is the network of connections that they bring all across the globe. Singapore is a success. I am a great admirer of Lee Kuan Yew's accomplishments. So what does Singapore do with their success? They reinvest, because they're not happy with the level of creativity, they're not happy with the level of innovation they're getting, so they continue to work with a new institution, with new practices. It's not confined to East Asia. Germany is by any standard a successful country, fabulous at manufacturing, but Chancellor Merkel decided about 5 years ago that she wanted a 7-3 program, as you would probably say here in Asia, 7% of GDP going to education, 3% going to research, and with the dogged, quiet approach that Chancellor Merkel always brings, that's what they're doing. They have a program of excellence where they're trying to bring their universities up to the very top level. I would just point out that Germany is a high-wage, high-regulated, high-tacked, unionized country. Exactly the sort of thing that American industrialists say is impossible to compete with, except the Germans compete very successfully. In America, we say, well, we have to get out of these commodity industries. I would advise you, the next time an economist talks about commodity industries, there are two definitions of commodity industries. One is, you can always tell a commodity industry if you don't know anybody who works in it. So then it's a commodity industry. I argue that that is actually commodity economics. People who are not paying attention to the type of competition, or above all, the evolution and the path dependency that you can develop. The big question when I was in Munich most recently was, who is going to make the cars of the future? And you know what they're concerned about at the Fraunhofer in Munich? They're not concerned about GM. They're not concerned about Toyota. They're concerned about Apple and Google. And one of the things they put up, to go back to the cell phone analogy, was the 2005 position of Nokia in cell phones. And then Apple appears the next year and blows them completely away. And they are not interested in being blown away again. But they are concerned. One of the things that they've done to have this outstanding success, well, they relied on the free market and they just hoped everyone would do well? Yeah, except that they set up 60 institutions to help them do well, all over Germany. They spend $2 billion a year, they have 20,000 employees, all providing an industrial commons to help their companies do well. This sustained and substantial investment is very, very impressive. I did a mission out there when we were doing some of our work for the White House on manufacturing programs. And one of our colleagues was objecting that they were actually subsidizing their companies. And the answer from the director of one of the Fraunhofers was, subsidizing, I'm not sure what you mean. We provide roads, we provide water, we provide power, and we provide Fraunhofers. What don't you understand about that? That's what we do. If you have a problem, that's fine. We'll just beat you in the marketplace. And he was pretty direct about it, by the way. So in the US, we have some strengths and we have some very serious challenges. One of the biggest strengths is that we're basically open to science and innovation. A deep concern when I'm in Europe, we were talking about the opportunities of new innovations, the way we can meet the challenges. And some of my colleagues from the commission said, and the important thing really is governance. We have to be able to govern innovation. And there are times when there's a chasm that opens across the Atlantic. I don't know any place in Washington where I could find someone who is concerned about governing innovation, with a possible exception of gene splicing. But we are open to that innovation. We have positive social norms. Another point of comparison, we think our successful entrepreneurs are rock stars. In France, they're always suspicious that they must have cheated. How else could they make that much money and get that far ahead? I'm serious, it's a completely different approach. But we also have forgiving social norms if your company fails. And why do we have that? Well, we have that because we also have gentle bankruptcy laws that allow a quick recovery. I put this slide up sometimes because it's just worth reminding people, one of the ways that the US succeeds in innovation is that we work at it. We invest in it the same way our Chinese colleagues do. We bring in talent from all around the world. I remember telling a group of members of the Czech Academy of Sciences that they must be a great deal smarter than the Americans. And there was this pause, and a couple of them looked at me quizzically. And I said, well, we have to import people from all over the world to run our universities. You run it just with Czechs. And we do. One of the sad things about some of the political dialogues in the US these days is people not understanding the contributions that foreigners make. I said we worked at it. We spend 28% of the $1.5 trillion spent on R&D in the US. Basically, we spend more than Japan and the UK and France and Germany combined. There are some problems with that money. but overall it represents a massive effort. We also understand the importance of small businesses. And I emphasize this point just briefly because, you know, for many years, Galbraith and others were focused on just the large companies as sources of innovation. Now there's a fixation on small companies. It's important to remember that large companies bring the resources, bring immense capabilities. But there's also the role of small companies that create most of the new jobs. They increase competition, they break up oligopolies and monopolies. And over time, you know, people talk about the US having these dominant large companies. Well, what they seem to leave out is that these companies actually were small at one point. I think there are enough people in this room who might understand that there was once a time without Google. And when I teach 20-year-old students, they really don't understand what that time could be like. As my son said once when he was in high school, he said, "Dad, is it true that you didn't have the internet when you were a kid?" And I said, "Yes, son, it was invented like 3-4 years ago, really." And he said, "What did you do? How could you find things?" You want to do a generational test, say the words card catalog and see if anybody understands what it is you're talking about. But I mentioned this broad-based federal effort. And, you know, working in this space for years, I think one of the things that we often leave out when we're talking about a national innovation system is that in the US, for the most part, not always, but for the most part, we're actually trying to do something. We're not doing research just for research. Most of the research budget is mission-driven. And even NSF, which is supposedly the National Science Foundation, which is supposedly just basic research, not only has applied research, not only has manufacturing institutes, but its award to two young scholars at Stanford went directly to Google. The NIH is sometimes underestimated. This has just moved up to $32 billion annually. And the scale of the funding there is often underappreciated. Why do I mention this? One of the things in a strategy for Hong Kong for collaboration is to work with the US innovation system. The US innovation system is the best funded and the most porous in the world. So if you're interested in international cooperation, where should you go? Well, do you know where everyone goes? They go to the NSF, the National Science Foundation. That's because it's almost the smallest. It's one of the smallest of our agencies. NIH, and they can't send money overseas. NIH can and does send money overseas. And it's, what, a little bit under 5 times what the NSF is. So we have some troubling trends, though, in the US. Everything is not perfect. You may have heard of the election cycle that we're having. I think most of us would agree that some improvements could be made in that. But we also have had stagnant or declining R&D for the last 5 or 6 years. That changed this last December. Half of our R&D is concentrated in the military, and much of that is in late-stage development, so arguably we're overstating what we spend on R&D. We have been cutting support for the US university system. It reminds me of some teenage kids banging away at the pillars in a church and not understanding what happens if you're successful in knocking down the pillar. We have cases of governors who are moving money out of outstanding universities in Madison, Wisconsin, and moving them into stadiums for the poor people who run the National Football League. We also have declining rates of entrepreneurship, which may be linked to the rise in student debt. But as a share of GDP, the federal government has been going down. But Hong Kong has some similar issues. If you look at your neighbors, I would find this a little bit troubling. Now, maybe you think you're smarter than everyone else and you don't need to spend so much money as the others. Or maybe, like in the US, you're not paying enough attention to critical elements of what makes an innovation system work. And by the way, when I say that the R&D should go up, I'm not suggesting just any R&D. I'm not suggesting block grants. When you look at what Korea is spending, not to mention the mainland or Singapore, I think there's reason to think that you need to make a larger effort. You also have a good news and bad news issue with the universities. On the one hand, there's been a rise in excellence. I was mentioning how impressive UST is. But a recent report by the Kong Foundation was arguing that there's too much focus on getting that next round of publications and not necessarily as much on applications. You know, I would remind you that some of the strength in the American economy came in the 30s and 40s and 50s when we were feverishly trying to apply the technologies that were developed in the Germany and the United Kingdom. Patents were respected, but the application was there. There's also, this comes from one of your own reports, the need to recruit more foreign talent. I think you want to avoid the Czech syndrome. And these, you know, education today is a uniquely international, global undertaking. And being able to draw, both send your people abroad and draw foreign talent here. And by the way, I don't mean just from the United States by any means. They're both opportunities for transfer within Asia and certainly with the U.S. and, of course, with Europe. So what are the major risks here? The major risks are that there's too much complacency, too slow a reaction. I think Professor Goldson's observations about the changes that are happening on the mainland, in the composition of the economy, and the impact they're going to have should be a wake-up call. So let me talk just very briefly about some of the myths and realities about innovation. And I apologize, I'll be quick, but one of them I like to point out to Americans is that many of them seem to think that there's some extraordinary quality of Americans. But it's the incentives in the system that have different outcomes. Why do I know that? Well, you know what the secret to Silicon Valley is? It's British managers, it's German capital, and it's Chinese and Indian entrepreneurs. That's the secret to Silicon Valley. The only thing we really bring is the sand. But that sand has the policy framework that I talked earlier about letting people take a risk. You know, there's a longer story, but the abbreviated one is that the founders of Google weren't sure they could succeed, were very hesitant. So what did the dean tell them? Take a shot. You'll regret it if you don't. And then the magic words, and if it doesn't work, just come back and take up your studies where you left off. In Germany, if you're in a state doctoral program and you leave, you've gone to the dark side. You're done. Over. Out. In another universe. At least another solar system. So keep in mind those fundamental points. This is the pride and joy today, which I'd like to knock right back. One of the most frustrating things when you're testifying to the U.S. Senate, and I've had that privilege a number of times, is when one of the senators say, are you suggesting picking winners and losers? Now, he thinks he said something really profound at that point. It just illustrates that he really doesn't know how the country developed or what's going on right now. The reality is that we have a pretty good track record of picking winners. There was a time when we didn't pick winners, but that was from 1792 to 1798. Since then, we've been pretty active. Eli Whitney was the guy who started to produce muskets. Very quickly, that became the foundation for the American machine tool industry. Simeon Norris was actually the guy who figured out how to do it, but Whitney got the credit. Samuel Morse was a portrait artist who had the strange idea that you could send signals down wires and they would be understood at the other end of the wire. He applied to the Congress for a grant. Many in Congress opposed it because they felt that God did not intend us to send signals down wires. They were right. It was supposed to be wireless, but it took us a while to get there. So, but he got $30,000 in 1842, which was a huge, that's basically $30 million today. It was a huge amount. The Wright brothers did their contract working with the Army. When I was studying economics, I thought the RCA was just a cool name, the Radio Corporation of America. No, it was set up by the Navy. It was set up by the Navy in cooperation with the Justice Department. The Navy provided equity, the money, and the Justice Department forced Marconi and Westinghouse and General Electric to pool patents to make radios. Josephus Daniels of the US Navy was convinced the British were going to be ahead of us in civilian uses of these technologies, and he didn't want that to happen. The Postal Act, I love this. Cohen and Noel once wrote a kind of a critical book about some government programs, but in the preface they point out that, well, some government programs have worked. You know, radar, jet aircraft, computers, semiconductors, basically the whole foundations for the modern economy. And no one probably here today hasn't already used GPS and internet. And it continues. I just like to kid people a little bit. I don't know whether you've ever seen Monty Python, when they when the guys want to revolt against the Romans, and as he's encouraged them to attack the Romans, he says, "What have the Romans ever done for us?" And the dumb guy says, "Well, you know, they're the roads." And then the scene fades in, and at the end they say, okay, so aside from the roads, the sewers, the medicine, the forum, irrigation, the water system, and the wine, don't forget the wine. And that's the same thing in the US. People often forget just how pervasive government investments in early stage technologies have been. Vernon Rutten has argued that there's been an important role from the government in technology development for every US industry, that has been competitive on a global level. Is that just old history? Well, this is what we're investing in today, both at the state level and with federal support, a series of awards for the National Manufacturing Network, a major initiative of the Obama administration. This is free market America, guys. This is don't interfere in the market. This is we never pick winners and losers. Well, revolutionary fibers and textiles could bring textile manufacturing back to the US. And you know, in the German slide, I was talking about retaining industries. Guess who's exporting textiles these days? Up 15% in the last couple of years. Yeah, the US. The textile industry is changing very rapidly, and the idea that it can all be done offshore is no longer the case. One of the things when we do want to invest in more R&D is the idea that it's a linear process. You know, I'll bet everybody in this room knows that this isn't true. And then you walk out and talk in the government circles or at the university. Is that basic or is that applied? Now, Alan Bromley, who worked for the first George Bush, the good one, was asked, how do you tell the difference between basic and applied? And he said, well, you know, really, it depends what you're working on at that particular moment in time. In fact, the innovation is a much more complex process. And often, technological breakthroughs may proceed as well as stem from basic research. You know, it's not this linear model. This is another model. One of the key things are the feedback loops to basic research. One of the underlying points here, I can't talk at length about the universities today, but a key point is that when you have questions coming from industry, often they are excellent topics for basic research, for publishable research, for the university community. For those who say that it's too expensive, the argument really doesn't cut. These are opportunities to invest in the future. It's not what the government is spending per se, but what it's spent on that really matters. Have any of you heard about, you know, that you can always count on the market? That if it's a good idea, the market will fund it? That's so satisfying. I know lots of people, usually in their third bourbon, they explain to you that the market will really fund it if it's a good idea. It's actually, if you know your theology, it's very Calvinistic in nature. You know, you can always tell who is blessed because they're wealthy. And if they're not wealthy, well, obviously they're not blessed. So, you know, no, you go to sleep every night knowing every good idea has been funded. The guys that tend not to agree with this are mainly in two groups, entrepreneurs and venture capitalists. They know better. The fact is that markets are very hard to figure out. There are a number of economists who have pointed out that we suffer from what they call asymmetric information, which simply means we don't know what's going to work or not. The result is that there's a valley of death here. Now, I apologize for the simplicity of this, but as I think Professor Goldston mentioned, I speak frequently to the American Congress. So what we want to do is figure out, with that federally funded research and these new ideas, how do they attract the money that they need to grow? The point you have to keep in mind is that these dead ideas are often good ideas. It's not because you don't have a good idea that you will fail. It's because you can't get the funding in time. You can't get adequate funding. You can't keep your team together. You can't get that prototype out. And you can't grow the company. At this point, people usually ask me, well, won't venture capital step in and solve that problem? Sometimes, but not all the time. VC is important, but it's only part of the ecosystem. When I'm in Europe, I hear over and over again, the problem here is we don't have enough venture capital. No, the problem is you don't have a sound regulatory framework to attract venture capital. I am very concerned about some of the ideas that I've been reading, that Hong Kong wants to co-invest with venture capitalists. Why don't you just create an environment that attracts venture capitalists? One of the other problems in Europe is deal flow. You know, in the US, we used to say that venture capitalists would only invest a day's drive from where they live. Until there were all kinds of super deals in China, then it was a day's flight. Okay, so if the deals are there, they will come. If you have a regulatory environment. Does this look like a poor city? Does this look like there's no money here? I mean, hello? So set up the rules to make it easy to write off failure, make it easy to carry losses forward. I mean, there's no secret to this. And by the way, a lot of people will lose money, but that's better than the government losing money. Let the venture capitalists lose the money, but let them carry those losses forward, set it up so that they can do it in a positive way. Venture capital markets, as the venture capitalists will explain to you, that there's a lot of stuff they don't know about companies. Bert McMurtry, a successful venture capitalist that I admire, he invested in a small company you may have heard of called Microsoft. He drinks really good wine now. And he was really funny. He said, you know, we bring the best people around. We get the best technologists, the best technical people, the best finance guys, the best managers. And we invest in 20 companies. And the one we did to keep John happy, the one that nobody else really wanted to invest in, that's the one that makes us all our money. He said, you just don't know. The idea that they're omnipotent is just wrong. By the way, this in 2013 was the seed phase. Do you really think that's what's driving the whole American economy? It's not. Is venture capital a huge asset? Absolutely. Does it enable you to scale? Does it provide networks? Does it provide managerial advice? Yes. Does it also sell you out when they decide you're not doing a good job? Yes. But they are, as an asset class, they run a loss. So my argument today is that if venture capital is oversold, the government's role is distinctly undersold. You hear this myth, just get the government out of the way. Well, that's okay unless you like shale oil and shale gas. We had a 20-year partnership with the shale oil industry. All they did was sort of provide the imaging technologies, the GPS system, the drill bits, the technology for doing horizontal drills, and when it was expensive, they subsidized the production. But aside from that, it was hands off. Okay? Just hands off. And has it paid off? Absolutely. The broader point here is that confident states have the vision and resources to take on risks. Why do they have to do it? Because in early stages for platform technologies, when you need early buyers, it's the government that can provide that. It's not something that a rational private investor will make. So let me talk, before I run completely out of time here, about two quick cases of U.S. intervention in the market. One of them, I think, is very much applicable to Hong Kong. We have what we call the Small Business Innovation Research Program. And basically, we have that $150 billion in research. We have social needs, government needs. Companies apply, and about 20% or less get a phase one award of $150,000, $200,000. It's been in operation since 1982. If they're successful there, about half of them are accepted for phase two, where they get $1 million, sometimes more. This is not part of the program. This is the private sector figuring out that there's been two stages of due diligence and there's a potential market with the government, so I'm in. Let me contribute. Sometimes problems are solved for the government with phase one. The algorithm answers the question. There's no recoupment. I can talk about this at great length and would be happy to. But no recoupment is important. If you're successful, we tax you. If you're not successful, we ask for nothing back. It hires people. It's government mission success. The Mars rover has multiple instruments that were developed by SBIR companies. You all have in your pocket an SBIR company product. Have any of you heard of Qualcomm? Well, the Defense Department thought that there was this very unlikely technologies, a CDMA technology that would possibly enable much greater use of spectrum. Most people were convinced, most technologists, most businessmen were convinced it would never work. But the Defense Department thought, you know, it would be really cool if it did work. So they gave SBRs to this startup company called Qualcomm, and the rest is history. This is kind of impressive. You know, we have an R&D 100 winners year after year. This is what has been running, the rate that has been running on SBRs. This is, you know, in a $16 trillion economy, 20 to 25% of the top R&D awards are coming out of the single program. We also need fast institutions for new entrepreneurial missions. So we have DARPA. Everybody's heard about DARPA. Not many people understand DARPA. One of the key things is that it's small, flat, and agile. It uses short-term contracts. It basically is a non-government government organization. It does everything governments try to keep you from doing, making decisions, making investments, accepting losses, garnering, reinforcing your successes, trying again if you fail the first time, all the kind of things that government accountants hate to see you do. Do I think this is easy to emulate? No, I don't. My understanding is that Japan is emulating it. They just think it should be not so flat, more hierarchical, take less risk, and be more consensual. Yes, exactly. Thank you for laughing. It's the non-DARPA DARPA model. Will it work? No. One of the key things about it is its willingness to take on questions that they call DARPA hard, that are really high risk, high payoff, and a clear willingness to terminate non-performing contracts. That is absolutely essential. If it's not working, stop, drop, and recommit. And by the way, for the policy people among you, when you're doing R&D tax credits, the problem with them, they can be helpful, but they're a very blunt instrument. They're just reinforcing a class of activity, whereas innovation awards are focused on a particular project, and if it doesn't work, you stop and use the money for something else. Whereas for an R&D tax credit, if it doesn't work, you keep paying. And there's also much less selection. Everybody gets to apply. So if you want to help McDonald's do new packaging, that's fine. But maybe that's not what you had in mind. So there are two views of the government. One is it's too heavy-handed, too distant, too inefficient, too expensive. And the other is it's one that's able to take risks and drive new ideas. A key message here is why should you take risks as a government? Because you have no choice. The future of Hong Kong depends on it. The future opportunities that your children will have depend on it. Your prosperity and to a degree your independence depends on being a prosperous, innovative place. And you can't do that without taking risks. So let me just close in the thought. I'm always amused when people think the US is all free market, or for that matter, just one huge hidden subsidy coming from the Defense Department. But if you can read this for a second, I've always been amused by these two traditions. One, Alexander Hamilton, who believed in what he called bounties to encourage companies to do what they should. And he was involved in the interchangeable musket parts. And then Thomas Jefferson's quip that the government that governs least governs best. And with the usual American pragmatism, we've worked this out. The Jeffersonians get the rhetoric, and the Hamiltonians get the practice. So we talk about free markets and then get the Department of Defense to put another $10 million into a promising project. So in conclusion, the world is changing fast. When people ask, should we do this? You know, it's sort of like you're sending teams out to compete, and you're asking whether you should train, asking whether you should invest in coaches, asking if you should invest in the best players. And if you're going to play, you have to play with the best you can. Other countries are doing this. I use the analogy that, I don't know whether you know, but the US Air Force is a great waste of money. There's no production that comes out of the US Air Force. Well, R&D advantages, the planes we fly, arguably, but broadly speaking, a waste of money. But you know, if other countries have air forces, I would like to have a good air force ourselves. The analogy here is there may be some perfect world where it's all free market competition. I think that's mainly in a textbook somewhere. But the rest of the world is competing hard. They're putting money in. They're learning from others. So I think in this world, you can either keep policy as it was before, or you work on developing the assets and the programs for an innovative future. And a key message is here is that if you want innovation, you need policy innovation. Innovation is policy, is a path to an innovative economy. Thank you very much for your attention. Want me to stay up for questions?
We now have plenty of time for questions and answers for Dr. Wessner. We have microphones that we'll bring to you so that everyone can hear. Anyone have a comment or question for discussion? Heard a lot about Hong Kong's future, so it's a topic that we're all pretty invested in.
Did you tell them that there's no questions as an exam at the end?
I'll start with a question myself while people think about what they'd like to ask. And that is, in terms of policies, we need good policies. Different countries, however, seem to have taken different approaches. For example, Netherlands and Germany invest an awful lot in vocational education. I don't know if all countries do that or is that one particular pathway. And similarly for DARPA, obviously the US has gotten a great deal out of a defense-oriented innovation center. Have other countries done that? So I guess what I'd like you to reflect on a bit is, are there many pathways to successful innovation policies, or are there a few that are proven that everyone getting their coach, getting their training regimes together, needs to make sure is part of their policy package?
Well, those are great questions. I think the broader answer is that it's important to learn from best practice around the world. And different countries have different economies that work in different ways. One of the remarkable things is that the U.S., which suffers, and I do mean suffers, from a level of complacency that I find frightening for our future, under this administration, they have started learning. And this is the first time in 20, 30 years in this space that the U.S. has been actively learning from others. They've used the work we did on Fraunhofer's to help fund this national network of manufacturing. They're actively working with the Germans and the Swiss to learn about their vocational training. There's been this recognition, and by the way, this is very important for Hong Kong, that not everyone in the world can go to a university and become a successful physicist. There are plenty of really good jobs that require high level of skills that you can accomplish in a 2 or 3 year training. The Germans are outstanding in that, with Siemens and others. You get tax benefits in there to do it. Don't expect the companies to do it all on their own. That's being imitated in the New York nanotechnology corridor, where Global Foundries is cooperating with places like Hudson Valley Community College to build out courses. You know, if they need semiconductor workers, there's two things they can do. One is they can go to the country club and complain we can't find the labor we need, or B, they can train them. They chose, to their credit, B. So they are closely involved in funding collaboratively with the state and with the communities to build out. So is there a perfect path, a single path? No. Is there best practice? Yes. The I left out the list of all the countries in the world that have, at least I think I did, that have copied the SBIR program. It's a very lengthy list. It includes South Korea, it includes Taiwan, it includes Japan, it includes Singapore, it's done well with it, it includes India, the Netherlands, Sweden, the UK. There are some countries that have not adopted it, like Greece, Spain, Portugal, Hong Kong. Depends what category you want to be in. When you are looking at a program, one of the key things is you may need to adopt it, but you also need to adapt it to your particular circumstances. So to try and answer that question, there are best practices. One of my jokes about SBR is if somebody has a better plan, I would be grateful to learn about it, and then we could copy it in the U.S. And failing that, you may want to think that the rest of the world, I left out Russia, didn't I? Russia has a really good program, they tell me, although there are no figures on it. It's a little bit like Russian agriculture. But in any case, the point is that it's been copied because it's proven effective. I led a $5 million study of this for the U.S. Congress. It took 5 years, and the final conclusion was the program is sound in concept and effective in operation. And this was led by the National Academies of Sciences, which is university-driven, which doesn't necessarily love small companies getting research money. I mean, the political reality is that. But the study found that it was very effective. So yes, there is best practice. Yes, it needs to be adopted and adapted. And the U.S. is nervous enough to be learning.
Good to hear. Question? In the back, if you wait for the microphone, please.
So, I want to ask something about the good measures of the policy of innovation or programs of the government. Now in Hong Kong, we always see facts like the occupancy rates of the cyber port, the Hong Kong Science Park, the number of projects being sponsored, or the number of patents registered, the amount of money spent, or even. But all these are just inputs or throughputs, but not the outputs measures. Now, what's the experience of the U.S. in ensuring, or how can we tell an innovative program is effective or not? What are the measures are you using?
Well, that's an excellent question. You're right to be, in fact, it's a sophisticated question. Only too often we measure inputs. You know, we spent this much money, so that's great. But that, of course, begs the question. But your intermediate outputs, the SBR program does well on publications. About half of the projects result in a peer-reviewed publication. About a third of them apply for patents, and a significant portion of those get patents. There is licensing income, which we measured. There is employment growth. There's sales growth. There's outside investment. These are all things that happen with SBR companies. And there's acquisition. One of the things we're talking about with SBR is what the Europeans call innovative procurement. Most of you, and I'm sure it's true here as it is elsewhere, most government agencies are surrounded and provided for by an oligopoly supply, if not a monopoly supplier. And SBRs are a wonderful way of getting past that. With respect you asked about DARPA, these are some of the, you have DARPA in your pocket. I mean, if you look at this list, whether it's a GPS, the touchstone screen, the cloud computing, the voice recognition, these were all DARPA investments. DARPA encouraged it at Stanford. Stanford sold it to SRI. SRI didn't do much, but they sold it to Apple and made a bunch of money. There's no justice here. It's just, but it's now in your pocket. And I left something out here. You've probably used the internet. So did these pay off? Yes. Is everyone going to have a DARPA? No. But you can have two things. One is an innovation agency that makes strategic investments, and it doesn't need to be huge. And then one of the advantages of SBIR, there's some magic words for the policymaker, it requires no new money. You simply take part of the procurement budget and you allocate it to small innovative companies. You put out a call for something you need. And one of the things I want to emphasize, it does not have to be super tech, super high tech. You know, it can be just better road signs with nano paint, a better software for running locomotives, for managing traffic, for developing smart cities. There's a whole raft of things you can do with these. And there are lots of needs. And sometimes it's basically contract research. The harbor's polluted, or at least was. What's it polluted with? How much of it is there? What would the remediation be? You know, what technologies would do that best? Those are things the government is not particularly good at answering. Small companies are. And it's a way of bypassing the usual consultants, and it's a way of bypassing the large companies. For defense, if we don't use SBIR, instead of giving $1 million to a small company, we give $20 million to Lockheed Martin. Then they find a small company and give $1 million to it and keep the 19 for overhead. So, you know, you can take your choice. My answer is that we have very solid record of very serious accomplishment. We also have something that's useful. So venture capital say fail early, fail quickly. This is a low-cost technological probe. Would this work? And if not, you know, no as an answer is a great answer. Because again, the alternative is we spend $200 million with Lockheed before we find that it really doesn't work. So you can fail fairly quickly, and that can be very helpful. You also have special needs things. You know, like I mentioned, the rover. You need a small, very lightweight, very low energy consumption that can drill, that can probe for water. How can you do that? Well, SBR is great. And there are a ton of things, some of them quite, you know, like syringes that have a protective guard to protect the nurse or the caregiver against hepatitis or HIV. They're working now on bandages that won't stick to the skin or actually become part of it. A ton of really interesting technologies that solve day-to-day problems that can be solved through these grants and then pushed into the acquisition process or pushed outside to the private sector. And I again want to emphasize that. The strength is that handoff from the public finance to de-risk the technology, to increase information, to provide an early market, and then pull that into the private sector for general use. It's not something that stands alone, although sometimes there are standalone uses for the government that the government has. Does that address your, at least in part, maybe?
So, next question.
Can I ask a question about the role of government? As I think in China, there is a very strong tradition of a very strong government, and there is always a heated debate on how much government should play in redistribution and manage the policies. And my question here is, like, it seems to me that the government should play a very important role in innovation. But in China, it seems like the type of government is very different from America and European countries, and it's like the government in China is more conservative, and they may not provide this kind of good solutions for the entrepreneurship. So can you elaborate a little bit about the role of government, and what type of government is best suited in carrying out this kind of mission?
Well, you know, you kind of have the government you have, and changing them can be tedious as well as bloody. So I think what you need to think about is how these programs can be applied. And one of the things that at least SBR has demonstrated is that it is being applied across a whole series of different countries with different size governments and different traditions. You're quite right that the at least parts of China, the Chinese government, have taken a different approach. You know, the provincial push to maintain employment, and everyone trying to run a steel plant, everyone trying to have an aluminum smelter, this has resulted in wild overcapacity that is creating problems all through the global trading system. It's what the Economist magazine calls zombies. They're companies that are not making money and are never going to make money, but they are supported by public funds. And I would argue those are pretty disruptive. The but there are also cases in China, in Beijing, as I understand it, where and in Shanghai, where awards are made by the provincial authorities to promising companies. It's very important that the awards be competitive, that the selection process be transparent. I talked about this once in Greece, and perhaps this applies in China, and a Greek official said, it's a good idea, but here everybody has an uncle. And if the process is not clear and open with clear criteria, that does not mean, by the way, that everybody is happy who loses. People run around and shout all the time, but finally, over 30 years, the program has had very few contestations, very few abuses. There was one guy abused it, but he's in prison. So from a more academic position, these massive overinvestments in production are disruptive and a waste of money, even if it's hidden. These smaller awards are really the opportunity for the future. And it's not an either or. A lot of times, more and more of the large companies in the US are paying attention to these small companies because of this due diligence process, and because, at least on the military side or on the NASA side, they know there's a market. For NIH, they sometimes make larger awards because they're trying to push the technology, which is promising, but to push it far enough down so that the private sector will pick it up. And sometimes they use matching funds. NSF, for example. Both NIH and NSF have a lot of money, but they don't buy anything. So what to do? So what they do is they tell the private sector, or they tell the company, if you can get $1 million or $2 million, we'll match you. So that's a great sales point. You go to your investor and say, you know, we get 2 for 1 here. You put in $1 and I'll get another dollar. And that's pretty compelling. But again, that pushes to hand that technology off towards the private sector. And in health, it's really hard. I mean, you know, you know, the standard joke in venture is if somebody comes and says we have a promising molecule, the venture guys to come back when you finish phase one. And they say, yes, but we need the money to do the phase one trials. And they say, yes, so come back when you finish phase one. You know, it's just go away. And that's where the that's where that valley of death emerges, and that's where the public sector can sometimes help. So I understand your point, but I think it's important to differentiate between massive industrial, old-fashioned industrial policy investments and these are innovation awards. I'd like to think of it simply as scholarships for companies. Highly competitive, you've got to be really good. It's different from the French programs. You don't get money because you're a small company. You get money because you're an outstanding small company. And we have a need for it.
I have a question in the back.
Thank you, Professor Wessner, for your presentation. I have a question about, you said Singapore and the U.S. have leveraged their diverse talent. And here in Hong Kong, even though it seems like a very cosmopolitan world city, at the board level of the, you know, the listed companies, there's shockingly low diversity rates. And I would presume the same at the decision-making level of the government as well. How much of an issue is this in terms of, in regards to innovation? And is diversity for diversity's sake the solution? Or do we actually miss out on being non-diverse?
Wow. Well, that's, as I say, an interesting question. As a general rule, one of the sources of success of our economy in contrast with the Japanese or the Saudis is that we employ our women actively and they have opportunities. But it's a half full, half empty. Do we do that better than most countries? Yes. Although the French do very well as well. The French do well in part for women's participation in the labor force because they've understood what Americans have never quite grasped is that after sex, sometimes there's children. And so they make provisions for daycare centers that are really top quality where you can drop off your child in the morning and pick them up at 6 o'clock. Ours tend to close before the offices close. In Germany, they're you know, they send them home from school 2 half-days a week, so, you know, what to do. And they also provide generous allotments to for people who have children who have less than, have modest incomes. The Sydney Padnos, if you're interested, has done a very good paper on women in venture capital. And it describes the discrimination in the Valley against women by venture capitalists. Venture capitalists lack imagination to some degree. They when they're 45, they remember what they were like when they were 25, and so they want to invest in themselves. And the fact is that women who do get venture have a higher success rate than men, which is one of the reasons I presume we don't give them much money, because it's so embarrassing. But they're more careful with the funds, less likely to go off on an ego trip. And I would recommend the paper to you. For the broader question of diversity per se, different cultures work in different ways. And I think there's a growing recognition that women in the workforce and even at the top levels are generally an asset. But I, despite the current political correctness of my country, I don't really feel that we can explain to Hong Kong, you know, with their 5,000 years of history, exactly how they should organize themselves. But do we have experience that shows that women are good entrepreneurs? Yes. Do we, but we have low rates of application to SBIR. And one of the reasons may be that we have a smaller cohort of women engineers. And where we have high cohorts of women engineers, like in biology, bioengineering, we still don't have high applications, which raises a problem. I don't know whether any of you are familiar with the old lady who kept praying to win the lottery, and she prayed and prayed, and finally there was a flash of light and a thunder, and there was a low voice that said, "Help me out, buy a ticket." So applying to SBIR is a really key way of winning. That's the first step in the process. And that's sometimes a serious point. I mean, we've had senators complain bitterly that their state doesn't get any, and then you look at the application rates and there's nobody applying. So hard to win. One of the things that SBIR has been protected against, though, is the good intentions of people wanting to reserve part of it for women, or part of it for women minorities, or part of it for women minorities of Indian descent who served in the service and who were disabled. And by that time, you have a welfare program. You no longer have a competitive innovation program. And it's a slippery slope. So far, we've managed to keep it not reserved for men, but when you try and do things officially, it's an intriguing area, but it gets very complex. We have set asides for women-owned small firms. So guys tell their wife that they've just become the owner of the firm, and they'll be the executive vice president, and, you know, that's not what we're trying to do. On the other hand, I have known extremely successful women. I was able to bring some of those entrepreneurs to my class to explain, not least to the women in the class, that, you know, I'm an engineer, I got this award from DARPA, and I now have a company doing good things. So it is arguably the public's money for early stage finance is going to be more unbiased in terms of gender than the private markets. Great question, though.
Earlier you discussed, argued that being small should not be an excuse for not investing in R&D. But I still wonder whether or not the scale does have some effect here, because if you look at much of the investment government make, right, some of them, you know, may just lead to the, you know, peer-reviewed articles or patent and so forth, but not necessarily that particular government or that particular country even can take full advantage of all the downstream benefit grow out of these technology innovations. So I just wonder whether or not government should be concerned about whether or not to lock in that potential downstream effect or benefit of all this investment, or that should not be the question at all for the government. Government should focusing on, you know, making more investment, regardless of how that downstream benefit would accrue to.
That's a great question. The first answer is that investing in R&D is generally a good thing. The returns, as Mansfield and others have demonstrated, are very high. The second point about capturing the benefits, the reason you all often want the government to do basic and early stage applied is that the private sector calculation is worse. They can't capture it for their immediate benefit. I mean, Stiglitz and others, and everyone has talked about the spillover effect and the inability of the firm to capture the full benefit of their investment. Hence, they underinvest in what is a public good. The public authorities can take a broader view of that. In California, when they made a major investment HIV therapies, but it doesn't matter, but they made a huge investment, and they wanted to capture it for the state of California. And the researchers were all quietly explaining to them that that's not actually how science works these days, that it's going to spread. It's a normal process. But the flip side of that is what you can do in Hong Kong is, first, invest in more applied research. Second, make sure that applied research is transparently competitive. I mean, that's one of the key things. When you're making block grants, you're just pouring money to the same network of old guys. I mean, that's what it amounts to. But the competitive applied, and also you need to set up what I would call a fishnet approach. That is a series of institutions and companies and incentives to anchor the research here. People will stay if there are opportunities. I mean, actually, it's what I'm talking about. the things you want. If a guy has an idea based on the research the government has funded and he wants to develop it, where can he go to get money? And where can he go to get that second stage money and that third stage money, not just the first startup? It's a very important point that was raised earlier, is that only too often you can get the first award, but there's no follow-up. That's a weakness of a number of programs around the world. A guy, an entrepreneur in Bratislava, said that this is the easiest place in the world to get $50,000 to start a company and the hardest place in the world to get $150,000 to do the next phase. So the phasing that we've had here, and by the way, you could envisage 4 and 5 phasing. You don't have to do exactly what we did. Having facilities that the company can use. So having money, having facilities, having an incubator program, having an accelerator program. I've not talked, I'll be in the course that we're teaching, I'll be talking about the I-Corps program that was developed at the National Science Foundation and by Stephen Blank in Silicon Valley, which is sort of a boot camp for entrepreneurs. And you know, the question you ask is really funny. As you go through it, when you're developing your company and your commercialization plan, you're supposed to figure out who your customer is. Who would have thought? So many companies go out and they want to develop this thing, which they're then going to give to someone. Well, who? And is that what they need? And often, not at all. So you have a whole cycle where you go back and you have to refine it. So this program is one that is designed where you have interviews over and over again with potential customers. And by the way, if you can't get the interviews, that's telling you something. So anyhow, it's a very good question, but you can anchor it. But there's a flip side to that question. If you make these investments in research, you have competent people here. They know what they need to know to take ideas from other countries' research program. I could think of the United States of America, for example, and develop products here. But if you don't have that intellectual competency, you don't have that training, you can't do it. That's one of the things we debate always in the U.S. Do we want to be way ahead in a few areas, or do we want broad-based? Of course, the answer is we want both. But if you don't have that broad-based competency, then you can't exploit new ideas.
Any other comments or questions, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Just now you mentioned the government funding for university to do research. I wonder if between the public and private USA universities, if they have a major difference in their sources of funding. And also, MIT and Stanford are very innovative universities. What makes these private universities stand out?
This is a good question. The, what makes them stand out is their culture. MIT was a land-grant institution. In 1862, during the Civil War, we basically democratized our higher education system, setting up institutions all around the country. It was free land, basically to work on agriculture initially, because that was the main part of our economy. But hence the name land grant. They were given land to be universities. But it brought a culture of applied research, which some in Germany denigrated as people who just weren't at the cutting edge, although in the early 1940s they found out perhaps they had underestimated the accomplishments of those people. That culture has expanded in interaction with the policy process. And this is a whole lecture, but I'll be brief, briefer than I have been. Before 1980, many of our universities had what you have, I think, here in, to some extent in Hong Kong today, but certainly in Europe, where there's a focus on basic research publications. With the Bayh-Dole Act, and the transfer of intellectual property rights, you had a major change in the incentives within the university. The best way to tell it is a vignette. In 1980, you know, when Professor Paul saw the dean took him aside and said, you know, Paul, you've been working a lot with this GE company. You know, that's not what we do here. You know, stick to your publications. If you want to join a company, go join a company. But you can't do both. You have Bayh-Dole and SBIR. Fast forward, in 2000, the dean talks to the guy's son, and he says, great article you have published. How's the commercialization coming? Do you think GE will buy this? Can you sell the rights? You know, completely different culture. And you have that because of the Bayh-Dole Act, you have that because SBIR argued the funding, and you have that because universities saw gain for the institution. So you change those incentives, and you get very different outcomes. Word of caution, you talk about Stanford and MIT. They are not typical American universities. Some of our universities are pretty good at commercialization, and some of them are really pretty bad at commercialization. It's not a homogeneous group by any means. I was at Case Western University talking about this program. I asked the vice president if they got many SBRs, and he said, oh, yes. And I said, great, how many? He said, well, you know, pretty much a lot. You know, if you're not measuring it, you're not managing it. They had no idea. So the encouragement, the expectation in the Stanford Engineering School and at MIT is that you will have a company, that you'll create companies, that your students will create companies. There's a push to evaluate professors on giving them credit for patenting activity, for cooperation with contract research, for founding a company. The old guard doesn't like that. It should be only publications. And one solution to that, which you might want to use with universities, is, which I've advocated this elsewhere and it's been successful, is set up parallel research institutes. So you have different rules. You don't, trying to reform a university, you ever see a picture of a World War I battlefield? That's what fixing a university looks like. So it's a lot of blood and no progress. So what you want to do is sidestep that and have a voluntary membership in a research institute where the rules are different. You don't bother people who don't want to do that, but it enables you politically to get past that whole quagmire of trying to change the way a university operates. But again and again, it's incentives. If you don't mind a word of humor, one of the things that 5-year study and those $5 million revealed is that professors like money. Who would have thought? But actually they do. And when they see John pull up in his Porsche and he's teaching environmental science, he's got SBIR awards, the graduate students are flocking to his courses and then joining his company, well, the other professors get the idea. And that demonstration effect, I'm not joking, is extremely powerful. Because the only thing they like more than money is being better than the other guy. So you get that competition, and that's a positive sum competition.
The other thing I'll add to that is that both Stanford and MIT have very deep and wide relationships with private companies.
Yes.
So private companies give scholarship money for students, students intern at the companies, professors meet with company executives, and they are very close ongoing partners in a variety of things. It used to be, you know, this culture of publication was universities sought knowledge, and they wouldn't sully themselves with marketing and profit-seeking. But MIT and Stanford dropped that a long time ago. And they said the future of the university is being closely linked to profit-making enterprises, and it works. I mean, they still definitely want their professors to win Nobel Prizes for pure research, but they see that as part of their portfolio. And they're just as happy when professors bring in a productive patent or when their students found a company as when one of their faculty wins a pure academic award.
And there's empirical research that shows that there is no trade-off between the ivory tower basic research and working with companies. The research shows that the teams that work with companies have more peer-reviewed publications than those that don't. So the idea that there's pure science on one hand and the tainted guys on the other is, but you know, that's something you guys need to get by, because there are some parts of the world that are really slow. I was talking to the Bundestag, and this brings it up because I was so shocked, and I was talking about this type of cooperation, and some of the, I guess, more left members of parliament said, well, doesn't that mean the research is sullied, that it's tainted? And I said, do you think MIT research is tainted? I mean, I wasn't very polite, but it was like, what are you talking about, you know? Now, you need rules if you're having research on a drug company's product and the drug company is paying for the research. Yeah, absolutely. But the idea that somehow the university knows better, I find the idea that companies are somehow... I worked at the National Academy of Sciences for 20 years. And if you don't mind the joke, at no time did any company try in any way to influence the outcomes or recommendations of any project, and I can't say that about any public agency. So the private guys really sort of buy in. I was mentioning we have a colleague here from Intel. I worked with Gordon Moore, one of the founders of Intel, for years, where he was giving back of his time to advise us on the importance of public-private partnerships. That's what's really funny. The real titans of industry get the joke. They understand that this cooperation is how we get places. And you have the, what I call the Anglo-Saxon disease, which are the economists who've never been on a factory floor, much less in a research hall, who are talking about how the government and industry can't do things together. They cause a lot of damage in my country, in the UK, and Australia. But both the Australians and the Canadians are trying to recover from this disease. They're very actively looking at adopting an SBR-type program. And again, not because they want to do an American program, particularly the Canadian, but they recognize that it's effective. And it's a key link from the university to the market. It pulls ideas out. So, great question.
You mentioned a few countries earlier that were quite successful in terms of their being focused on research and that lead to development and improving their economy, as well as on the other side of the spectrum, some countries in Europe that were that didn't invest. So in terms of time frame, because I come from a country that has a six-year presidential term and our new president comes into office by the end of next month. So more or less, these are tips that hopefully can reach his office. So for it to have a particular impact, how long and around what percentage of GDP are we looking at for a similar initiative to really take off?
Well, that's an excellent question as well. It depends on where you are. A few years ago, a decade ago, the European Commission decided that they would have a 3% target for R&D as a percentage of GDP, which was silly because they didn't have the absorptive capacity. They might have been able to double all the awards to the researchers, which they would have liked, but it wouldn't have changed outputs. I mean, the question that was raised earlier about the importance of what do you get for it? So you need to understand to some degree what the system can absorb. The important thing is, as the excellent report from the Kung Foundation, I think it was, is it encouraging encouraging more applied work and making sure that the awards are competitive and, you know, start with a significant increase and then run it up slowly. Although politically, sometimes you have to take something quickly off the table. If you can get the percentage up as a way of holding it, then you should do that. Governments always imagine they're in forever, and they're usually in for about 18 months. So if you can do something faster, that would be worth doing. One of the things that has impressed me about the Taiwanese government, for example, and the Singaporean government is their ability to hear an idea and at the very top levels decide if they're going to do that or not, and then do it. And that ability for decisive, rapid decision-making followed by prompt execution, I think, is a distinguishing advantage of the Confucian tradition you see here in East Asia. More funding quickly, but not too much. And then the question is doing prizes. If you do prizes for the best technology or best discovery, and then prizes for the best business plan to exploit it, and include those prizes with 5 or 10,000 euros or dollars, whatever it is, and then have a way of applying, now that you have a business plan, to a state-supported or a regional SBR-type award, to try and pull that towards the market. The whole trick is, how do you get it out of here and into the market? And why do you want to do that? It's not just to be crassly making money. It's because that's when the society gets a benefit back from what you've done. And if you want more R&D dollars, which is more effective? Telling a congressman or a member of the parliament that we have a whole series of new publications, or tell him that in his district there are 3 new companies that are employing 70 people? I mean, not hard to figure, is it? But my basic point is that we're trying to solve health problems, we're trying to solve energy problems, we're trying to solve cybersecurity problems, and to do that, you need to push it into the market where it can be tested and reworked. Not everyone's going to succeed. Sometimes those companies go bankrupt, but the idea goes on. The principal investigator takes that knowledge and goes to another company. He may found his own. So we can talk in greater detail if you like. But spending more intelligently in cooperation with industry on applied research can have a much higher return. The Finnish Minister of Finance, when we were talking about this very question once, turned to me when I said that more R&D would be good. He said, "What exactly will I get from an increase in R&D from 4.2 to 4.3% of GDP? I've always remembered that as a hard question.
We have time for a couple of more questions. Yes, we do have a couple of more. There's one, please, on my right.
They were slow to start, but I didn't think everyone would ask a question.
Well, they pick up.
Hi, Professor. I note from your background that you have addressed certain countries or international organizations about how technology can address certain security challenges. Could you name a few? Because I'm just interested in some insight as to what kind of industry that maybe security industries or police can cooperate with some innovative companies to bring that forward.
Sure. we all have the obvious example. We all have an interest in improved cybersecurity so that we can continue to interact with each other in business and socially in safety. One of the security areas that I'm increasingly interested in is that of health. We spend about $2 trillion a year on military security, or at least military investments. Whether or not they're more secure is an open question. But we spend abysmally little money on strengthening health institutions in developing countries. Why? Because they're our first line of defense. What we've discovered from SARS and from Ebola is that they're 12 hours away from downtown LA. So we have to recognize that we need to work harder to provide incentives for drug companies. Developing a new vaccine costs in the order of $150 to $200 million, and it involves serious liabilities. Many of the drug companies spend a lot of money on HIV, and then you meet people that want to make it free, it shouldn't cost so much, and they don't think about, well, who's going to develop the next drug. Same with Ebola. We have made progress thanks to the Canadian and American cooperation, including incentive awards to the companies. So that's one area where we need more security. I'm not even going to say in a broader sense. I'm much more concerned about Ebola-type diseases than the Canadians coming across the border. So we need to make those investments. And then more broadly, you know, you can also define security. One of the things the Dutch did when they started an SBR program, which has had been rocky because it hasn't had the continuity and scale it needs, but guess what the Dutch first call for their SBR program was? Anyone have any idea what it would be? What most concerns the Dutch? Dikes, exactly. That's exactly what they did. And they got two awards. One was to put sensors in the dike to detect movement, and the other was to use geostationary satellites to measure movement in the dikes and measure the water temperature and a variety of other things. But I just found that both funny, but of course real. What, you know, this is existential issue for them. The Dutch insurance companies don't think that global warming is somebody's myth. They want it stopped. So I hope that addresses in part your question. But these are, but we use also these awards we use for a broad range of security applications. But again, one of the really good things in the report by that Kung Foundation was that a lot of applications that will make money, that will meet social needs, that apply new technologies are, actually I should reverse order, apply new technologies, meet social needs, and make money, are not necessarily high tech. Remember, the iPhone is not high tech. It's not cutting edge technologies. It's a brilliant reassembly of existing technologies. And there's a ton of money with existing business models that can be used. That's where the business schools here can play a huge role. Keeping in mind that many business schools don't teach innovation and entrepreneurship. They teach how to join a merchant bank. So there are changes that are needed there.
That's a good lead-in for a question from one of our associate deans at HKUST Business School.
So actually, I have one comment and also one question. For the comment, I fully agree with you. VC matters, but not VC is not everything. So in fact, Hong Kong is actually the capital of VC. About 27% of VC's money is kept in Hong Kong, but they don't invest that much in Hong Kong. We actually asked some of the VC investors, they said, why you keep money in Hong Kong, but don't you spend money here? Firstly, let's say Hong Kong is definitely a very decent financial center in the world. So money is kept here, they feel safe, easy, you know. That's the strength of Hong Kong. But at the same time, they're very picky. So let's say normally we pick up one project among every 200 projects. But in Hong Kong, how many projects you can give to me, you know? So if you stay in Hong Kong, we'll be hungry. But if you go to Shanghai or Beijing, you know, every day there can be thousands of proposals come to you. It's very easy to identify some of the potential projects, right? So that we say, you know, we do have the VC, but you know, we don't have a good ecosystem yet. So it's a pity, you know, we cannot fully leverage the VC. My question is, you say, you know, Hong Kong looks very rich. That's true, you know, the private investor, they do have money. But the question is, how can the government motivate the private investor to invest in R&D or innovation? What kind of policy is more effective? Tax rebates or some other, you know, policies?
That's a great question. And by the way, there are many regions in the United States. The point is that venture funding is very concentrated in the U.S. on both coasts and in just a few cities. So there are places like Cleveland or Pittsburgh, which, or Detroit, which have the same problem. There, I know venture capitalists leave in Cleveland but never invest any money in Cleveland, although they're frequently criticized for that. It's also important to keep in mind the distinction between, you know, the venture guys are usually, some of them are pompous and silly, but many of them are pretty straightforward, and they're looking for big deals. They're looking for a $1 billion deal. So if you tell them that there's a company that, you know, could expand to employ 600 people and have a $300 million revenue, they're like, so? So, you know, good luck with that. Whereas if you're in charge of a province, or if you're living here in Hong Kong, this is great. This is true all over the United States. These are ideal companies to have. And many of them are not large, and many of them are not going to offer the liquidity and returns that the venture would want. And many of their technology trajectories can be cut short by impatient venture investors. You know, let's sell these guys, get some money, and we're done. The incentives, I think we could go through a list of them, but I briefly mentioned a few. Some is the carrying losses forward. I would be cautious about the co-investment, because there's always a tendency to socialize the losses and privatize the gains. And I would argue further that for venture funding, if you get the deal flow in place, the venture guys will take their shots and take their losses and make their money or not, as they should. And you need to help them with a constructive, transparent, simple regulatory environment. I'm just amazed at the number of countries in Europe that just go wandering around saying they need venture capital, but they'll never change the rules to allow venture capital. So they don't get venture capital. And the one way to address the deal flow is what we've been talking about. You provide 21st century entrepreneurial universities that are encouraging professors to take things out. You recognize, and we didn't talk much about this, there are lots of small companies that have interesting ideas. These are already existing companies, already functioning, already profitable. 75% to 80% of the SBIR awards go to those companies. There's this startup mythology, you know, everybody's going to come out and start his own company. Now, actually, taking an idea to an existing company that has a back office, that has a CEO, that has a legal department, is often much more effective than, and of course, the colleague from Intel being here reminds me there are corporate venture arms, which can often be an opportunity. But the idea is to generate the deal flow, and to do that, you need to provide some initial funding, and you need to provide a culture. You know, you were mentioning some really great points about the cooperation with internships and sabbaticals and contract research, but you also need entrepreneurial leave. You know, can you go out and come back? And it needs to be real. I don't know whether you know, say, CNRS in France has entrepreneurial leave. But it's run by a bunch of communist unions, and literally. And if you take that leave, then you're discriminated against for promotion and who you are and what jobs you get inside. So it's a good example of where the formal rules are there, but the culture doesn't work. In any case, that's a long, well, I hope not too long an answer to a complex question, but the basic answer is make it easy for them, make it attractive for them, and provide them with deal flow, and also reach out to them. You know, having them come in and talk to students. Professors generally hate professors of practice because they know so much. So it's important to bring those advisors in and knit those connections. That, back to your question, that's certainly what Stanford and MIT do. Having mentors on site, having incubators on site where people can learn, can be extremely helpful.
Time for one more question. If anyone wants to get the last word, or next to last word, we'll give Professor Wessner the last word.
Thank you, Professor. So we talked a lot about reachability, marketability, as well as implementation. So I have one specific question in terms of, in referencing to maximizing the spectrum of diverse capacities, it was mentioned earlier, as well as recognizing the different levels of needs in society, whether it's here in Hong Kong or around Asia. Do you think that there's any value in engaging the grassroots communities and the local communities in this, or are they just going to be either spectators or just part of the cycle?
No, that's a great observation. You know, there's a lot of innovation on what they call the bottom of the pyramid, and you can address, again, through awards, prizes for solutions that to problems that are perceived by those groups, and often, you know, in India they have sometimes just the most amazing solutions to, rather than a high tech, high energy, expensive, you can get these really unique, low cost, easily assembled solutions, and then sometimes a combination of that. You know, the big push on in India for photovoltaic power generation to power cell phones, which then provides information for crops and for women and breaks through some of the barriers that otherwise exist and connects them to the world. And then the whole option of local apps to meet local needs. We have challenges, but this is such an incredibly exciting super time with solutions that are, you know, huge problems, but also marvelous solutions that are coming forward that, you know, you're able to, a woman who used to have to stay in her hut and go to bed every night with dark and now can plug in a charger, cell phone, and keep a light and teach her daughter to read and find out about crop information, and if she's sick or if her daughter is hurt, she can put that on the equivalent of FaceTime and get a physician to look at it. I mean, this is really pretty cool stuff, and the world is changing very rapidly there. But the short answer is yes, there's, but it has to be, in my view, there's got to be a business orientation to it. You know, what is the business plan? Using scarce public funds to support groups so that they can advocate for more funds like they do in France. I mean, literally, you fund an association, you get funded by the state to fund the association, then your main point is to ask for more money from the state. That's one path, but I don't recommend that. In any case, I like to kid our French friends, but you should remember that they have higher rates of entrepreneurship than the Americans do. And they have very high rates of initially successful companies. Some of their problems come with scaling. And that's arguably due, at least in part, to the policy framework where once you go above 50 employees, then you have the pleasure of meeting your co-owner, who is the trade union leader, who comes in to explain how you're going to run the company. And that doesn't work so well.
Well, thank you very much for this presentation. I'll point out that the motto of the Institute for Public Policy is innovation for global leaders. It's because we believe policy, just as much as business, has to be an arena for innovation, especially if the two are going to work together. So that was our theme for today. It'll be our theme essentially for most presentations as we go forward. Thank you all for coming today, and thanks again to Professor Wessner. Thank you.
Thank you. Sure. Great set of questions.
We'll probably have pictures.
Sure. Point.